Good evening. So my name is Bruno Dercom. I work for the United Nations, for UN Habitat here in Japan, in Fukuoka. And our work spans over Asia Pacific, important countries. We deal with slums, with housing and urbanization. These issues are very big in Asia. Asia has the biggest cities, the five biggest cities, now already, and it will go on for the coming decades like that. In our office, in our organization, we also dealt with a lot of disasters. I personally counted yesterday, I dealt with disasters in which 4 million homes were destroyed. Even for me alone, 4 million homes, which is an enormous number. I come from Belgium. 10 million people, we probably have 2 million homes, and personally I have to deal with 4 million. These are very big challenges. Health. The main reason nowadays in developing Asia for women in terms of risks and causes of bad health and death is pollution of the air inside houses. It's even not water the main reason. The main reason is pollution inside houses from stoves, from firewood, from all reasons, especially women and girls are confronted with. And then we have, of course, the tsunamis, the earthquakes, and all the other suffering. There's a lot of change in Asia. The urbanization you can't stop. It's all becoming urban. Google is going down. So much things. There are so many disruptions for so many people, and that's what we call, they're called the wake-up calls, because these big things happening to us, and we go after them, and we try to shift, we call it building back better in case of disasters, or for your habitat, for a better urban future. And we look for the opportunities. And where are the positive disruptions? Because there are opportunities for us. In our case, we are small organizations in Fukuoka. We just work with about 10 people, 10, 15 people. And we are having, in the past 10 years, we reached out to about 10 million, 15 million households, which is an enormous number. In countries like Afghanistan, Myanmar, Bangladesh, Sri Lanka, and so on. Let's start with this, the basics. That's a publication of UN Habitat together with the Environment Program Unit of 2010. That is striking title, Sick Water. Yeah, really the problems of every day, but I said for girls, women especially. But let's go back, 1809, 200 years back. I come from Belgium. In 1809, the British Army invaded the Netherlands in order to occupy my home city Antwerp, in order to get out the Dutch. They failed. They were defeated. They were not defeated by the French. They were not defeated by Napoleon. They were defeated by mosquitoes, by malaria. In my country, 200 years ago, by malaria, they were defeated. And what happened with the British Army, they said, wait a minute, we have to organize ourselves, evacuation, saving life. And out of that came humanitarian assistance, as we know it today. 15 years later, 1859, in Switzerland, in Geneva, something was set up. It was called first the Committee of Five. And in that committee, most people were from the Health and Hygiene Committee of the city of Geneva. And there was one famous person in that, and that was Henri Dunant. Because they had seen war, and they had seen suffering of victims, civilians, and soldiers, and they set up what is now called the International Society Federation of Red Cross and Red Crescent. And the principles were born at that time. It was about global in reach, reaching out to all countries, all people, and in full neutrality, irrespective of political affiliation, race, gender, religion, and nationality. 1859. And so it's, this is what we do as a Union Habitat in Afghanistan. In 2002, we are still working there 10 years after in Afghanistan. We have very big programs with a lot of Japanese assistance. And this is what we do after 1809, after 1859. Mm-hmm. So it's a small jump, and I'm almost now in Fukuoka. 1846, the founding of the United Nations with the big global principles: peace, human rights, justice, social progress. And social progress was what brought us in Fukuoka. Fukuoka offered itself as a home for Union Habitat Asia Pacific. Fukuoka, 40 years ago, a lot of pollution, a lot of environmental problems. 30 years ago, there were water shortages in Fukuoka in the summer, in the rainbow. There was not enough water in Fukuoka. Now it is constantly voted as the most livable city of Japan, and internationally as one of the most livable cities in the world. What a progress, that's social progress. And so we are very proud to be here. But we deal with disruptions. Our work is not in Fukuoka. We are working from Fukuoka, and we are doing that, for instance, here in Afghanistan. This is our principle. What we are doing actually is working with people. You can't have urbanization without people urbanizing themselves, working together. Our principle, our positive disruption comes from our way of working. We let people work together to be in the forefront of changing cities or overcoming crisis. This case is Afghanistan, where we don't do any slum upgrading, or we do not do any reconstruction without women setting up development councils, doing elections for them, electing their own leaders, making sure that development councils are managed by their own people. Without that, no money, no funds. Elections first. We look at the opportunities. This in Indonesia. We are giving a lot of money. That's about development assistance. But that money goes straight to bank accounts of these development councils. So a lot of teaching ongoing. Financial literacy. How to manage funds. How to manage contracts. How to manage contractors. We don't do it. We expect community groups to do it. This is our social business. You see people working, they have their money on the bank account. We worked in villages where women could not read, where men probably in their lifetime had not seen more than, say, $200 at a time. And for reconstruction after the tsunami, they managed $1 million. And it's possible. That's really a positive disruption. Here in Mongolia, Mongolia is an empty country. Few people, 2.5 million people. And they were herding cattle on an enormous countryside. And everything went wrong, wrong climate change and so on. People came to the city, herders, group people, coming down in slums in the capital. We were working with them. But they set up the committees for city development. Because all the new slums of Ulaanbaatar, well, we need the people around them to say, where will we build schools? Where will we put street lighting? Which are the crucial spots where the street lighting is necessary in order for women to feel safe? We don't have money to build street lighting everywhere at the same time. So the planning is done by them. And again in Indonesia, the technical learning, how to build sanitation in slums and cities. It's not easy, believe me. Every slum is different. You can't say, wipe it out, start anew. No, everything goes wrong. Yeah, what are the nice parts of Fukuoka?
and disturb students and school areas took a lot of years to put it right. Same here, there is a lot of thinking by people to put in sanitation in the right way to keep still the quality of the environments where they live. And out of that comes social business, water kiosks. These are small businesses where a small outlet is set up, water is supplied, but it is sold by community groups to the community. Because that's the only way to keep it going. Otherwise, it dries the first water, no maintenance, no operation, collapses 2 years after you leave, nothing anymore there. Now it's a business. And that's the result. And so this is my message. This is our campaign, The City Changes. Who are the city changes? Who are my main positive disruptions? Are these community groups? Going through education, assisted with funding, but the real change comes from them. It's my same message to you. It's probably still necessary also in Japan. It's still necessary for all that. We have our campaign, I'm a City Changes. We have our website. What your stories are about positive disruption in making cities better. For elderly people in Japan, youth initiatives, working with poorer people, caring for the environment, making bicycle tracks, setting out initiatives to visit unknown places, all these things that are also relevant here. These are the stories we need. These are the stories that also need to come from Japan to the United States.